This time on Film Ranger, we are looking at Wes Anderson. There is nobody with a more instantly recognizable style. The symmetry, the color palette, the repertory of actors, the cool soundtracks, narrators, even the fonts. Everything in a Wes Anderson film can only be in a Wes Anderson film. It is bold and quirky and accessibly artistic in all the best ways. Even his worst movies are pretty terrific. But let's dive in and count down all nine of his films from the worst to the best. Number 9, Bottle Rocket. Anderson's first film is the only one that doesn't really look like a Wes Anderson film. This shoestring budget heist movie is certainly not a bad movie. There's a very good reason that it became a cult classic and started Wes Anderson and the Wilson brothers on their trajectory to fame. It's funny, it's quirky, and is well worth tracking down if you missed it. But it is obviously an unpolished first film. Number 8, Life Aquatic with Steve Zissou. Life Aquatic has some of the most beautiful shots of any Wes Anderson film, and two fantastic supporting performances from Willem Dafoe and Cate Blanchett, but it doesn't have the story to go with the visuals. The father-son angle never really works, the tiger shark revenge bit is dropped early, the rescue thing feels like a weird afterthought, and the fight with Jeff Goldblum for the love of Angelica Houston never really gets off the ground. The problem is it doesn't feel like Zissou himself cares about any of these things. So we're kinda left wishing that we've met him 10 years earlier. Number 7, Darjeeling Limited. Anderson makes some bold deviations here from his usual form. While Anderson is usually steady, centered, and in complete control, Darjeeling feels improvised, off-kilter, and constantly in motion. Occasionally, that works beautifully, especially in a few early scenes as we meet the brothers, but unfortunately, that relationship runs out of steam a little bit too quickly, and there isn't enough structure around it to keep the film afloat. The best part of the film is the mini prequel Hotel Chevalier, which is well worth tracking down. Number 6, The Fantastic Mr. Fox. Here's where things jump from good to great. At the time, this seemed like a strange choice for a director whose biggest strength is his camera work to move to the confining realm of stop motion. But once we saw Fantastic Mr. Fox, it all made perfect sense. The Roald Dahl tale about a charismatic fox was actually the perfect base for a Wes Anderson film. He clearly loves the story and gets what makes it tick and adds the perfect splashes and the perfect places to make us all see exactly what he sees. Also, Clooney is fantastic. Number 5, Isle of Dogs. Anderson's second stop-motion animated feature builds on his first in every way. The story is bigger, the stakes are higher, and the visuals are phenomenal. All of Anderson's films feel collaborative, but this one even more so. The East meets West style is beautiful, the troop of dogs feels like a real family, the off-island elements add to the story of the boy, the whole thing is clearly a labor of love, and it is very easy to get on board. Number 4, Rushmore. While Bottle Rocket was the first film Anderson made, Rushmore is the first real Wes Anderson film. This is where he established many of the tropes that would go on to define his style. The yearbook photos, the deadpan deliveries, the centered shots, and perfectly coordinated colors, it's all there. But like Max's tremendous high school plays, it isn't quite all the way there. What really brings this movie over the top, however, are the lead performances from Murray and Schwartzman, who would thankfully go on to be the core of Anderson's troupe. Number 3, Moonrise Kingdom. Anderson is certainly no stranger to making movies for smart children, but this may be the best of the bunch. It is, of course, not just a kids' movie, but when you really look at it, it shares a lot of DNA with those live-action Disney movies we used to watch on Sunday afternoons. It's just way, way better. It of course looks phenomenal, with the coastal setting giving Anderson even more opportunities for striking visuals, and the kids at the center of it are fantastic. But it's the supporting cast that really makes it sing, especially Edward Norton and Bruce Willis, who are perfect additions to the repertory of Anderson players. Number 2. The Grand Budapest Hotel. This is maybe the most obviously Wes Anderson of any Wes Anderson film. It's the most symmetrical, the most color coordinated, and most smoothly shot of the bunch. It is undoubtedly gorgeous. You can take any frame of this film, blow it up, put it on your wall, and people would think it was a perfectly reasonable piece of art. But for how terrific it looks, what sets it apart are the performances, especially Ralph Fiennes as the lead. Fiennes has always been obviously great, but here, he is fantastic. Number 1. The Royal Tenenbaums. While Rushmore hinted at Anderson's style, it is the Royal Tenenbaums that solidifies it. This is still Anderson's most grown-up film. It's the one that best combines quirky comedy and real drama, and the one that most makes his strange world feel relatable. Anderson's kind of riff on Salinger's Glass Family, All Grown Up, features career-defining performances from every single person in the cast. The characters are complex and interesting. There are enough themes to fill an entire semester of film school. The style is gorgeous and groundbreaking, but at the same time, it's just a fun movie to watch. It's that rare film that has incredible depth, but works at every layer. And that's it. If you haven't seen any of these 9 movies, go watch them. If you have seen them all, let me know which were your faves, and please like and subscribe and watch some of the other videos you see on the screen right now. And hopefully, I'll see you all next time.